Morning, I'm Keith Wiener. Everybody feel it's a good morning so far? My job this morning is to convince you maybe otherwise. Ladies and gentlemen, unfortunately, our monetary system is going off the rails, and that's what I'm going to be talking about this morning. This is a two-part lecture. We don't have a date scheduled for the second part yet. We'll have to talk with Mike about that. The first part, I'm going to be talking about what's wrong, what's broken, exactly how the dynamic is playing out. There's a lot of aspects to this that are counterintuitive. And in the second part, I'm going to be talking about what a proper gold standard might look like, must look like, in fact, if it's to work, and how we actually transition from here to there. So I'm working on my PhD in economics, and that transition, my proposal for a transition, is going to be a key part of my dissertation. So this is a picture of how we're going off the rails. Obviously, the dollar bill is in flames here. A lot of people like to talk about how consumer prices are going up. And I don't think that's really terribly good measurement. I don't think it's terribly relevant. There are a lot of different forces on consumer prices. But I think the appropriate way to measure value is against the only objective money, which is gold. And so this is a graph of the value of our dollar as measured in gold, the average annual price going back to 1900. And we noticed that for a long time, the value of a dollar was about 1/20th of an ounce of gold. And then something started to happen, and this is an ever faster accelerating collapse against gold. So this chart needs a little bit of updating. This was somewhere in the middle of 2011 when we had $1,600 an ounce. I would bet money, in fact, I am betting money, that in 2012, the average price will be considerably higher than $1,600 an ounce. Everybody recognize Mr. Hemingway? The story that I'm going to be telling today is a story of bankruptcy. That is not a story of the linear quantity of dollars. This is not a story that the Fed is going to print dollars to infinity. In fact, my thesis is that at the end, perhaps the quantity of money will actually be falling, and I'll get into that a little bit, just what we mean when we say money, i.e. the dollar today. So Hemingway was a fairly witty guy, whatever else you may think of him. Somebody asked him, how did he go bankrupt? Well, gradually and then all at once. And that's the story of the US government and the dollar. All right, so I want to cover a bunch of topics today. I want to cover the origins of money just enough. This is obviously a topic in itself, but just enough to give some background and some context to what I'm talking about as we start talking about the irredeemable debt-based paper currency that we have today. It's technically not a pure fiat currency. It's not just printed and then handed out. It's actually borrowed into existence. That's one of the things that is very counterintuitive about it. Interest rates are incredibly important, and that's a big, big, big part of how the system is coming off the rails today. It's upside down at the moment, but trust me, I'll rotate it when we get there. I want to talk about inflation, and then I want to get into arbitrage, and then specifically gold backwardation is a very key part of my thesis as well. And I think that's going to be the mechanism by which it actually happens at the end of the day. So the origins of money. Where did this stuff come from? Why do we need it? So if you look at early man, I don't know if this was 10,000 years ago or 8,000 years ago or 15,000 years ago, rising up out of a pure subsistence existence. So there was some point when, you know, people just went out and hunted and gathered berries and nuts and roots and whatever, and at some point started to accumulate enough capital that they could have specialization of labor. And one person could, let's say, make the leather moccasins, another person could start cultivating wheat or some sort of grain, and then they would trade between each other, which is an enormous step up from the subsistence existence where everybody has to do everything for himself, and the failure to do one thing for yourself obviously results in death. Then you run into a problem. An economist called this the coincidence of wants. What happens if I'm the guy who makes the leather moccasins and I go to this young lady here and say, I'd like to trade for some of your wheat, and she says, I've already got leather moccasins. No thanks, I don't need that right now. So there's no trade possible between us at the moment because of this. There's no coincidence of wants. I need what she has, but she doesn't need or want what I have. So we need something that makes indirect trade possible, and that's another step up, a quantum leap in efficiency from subsistence. And it turns out that there's one good that's more marketable than all the others. So when I sell my leather moccasins, I could trade it for chickens, I could trade it for walking sticks. There's all sorts of goods out there that might be available, but one of them is more marketable than all the others. And by a process that we see in the internet today, accelerated 10 to the 50 times faster, there's a process called winner take all. The one good that is more marketable, the one good that everybody tends to prefer when they trade, then becomes even more marketable than it had been previously. And so this most marketable good has at various times been salt, it's been cattle, it's been wheat, it's been gold, it's been silver, it's been seashells on certain Pacific islands, and so forth. And that is the origin of money in a nutshell. Now we get into something a little bit more technical. Most people think, what is the price of something? And they think there's one price. You go to the car dealership and you say, I want to buy that Chevy Volt. And they say, this is the price. Or you say, what is the price of gold in the market today? There's actually two prices. And it's incredibly important to realize that there's a bid and there's an ask, or it's also called the offer. And the offer or the ask is always higher than the bid. Structurally, it is necessarily that way. If it ever got inverted, somebody could make a lot of free money flipping it back. And there's a spread between the two. And there are two concepts that economists talk about, marketability in the large and marketability in the small. So to cut to the chase, marketability in the large is the good whose bid-ask spread tends to widen the least as you deal in larger and larger values of it. Today, that happens to be gold, far and away. You can go into the gold market with very, very large amounts of gold, either as a buyer or as a seller, and not really move the price all that much. Marketability in the small is very, very important as we evolve the concept of money and monetary system, and as we evolve the concept of savings. Because if you're a wage earner, and you take 10% of your weekly wage, and you want to save it, you're talking very small amounts of wealth, all things considered. And this bid-ask spread is a frictional loss. If every time you have to buy, you buy at, let's say, 15, and every time you sell at 8, well, that's a recipe for loss of half or more of your weekly wage. You need something that you can get in and out of in small quantities, and for thousands of years, that substance has been silver. Silver is the most hoardable for the wage earner. Gold is the most liquid for large transactions. Another key concept here in understanding all of this is the concept of stocks to flows. So if you look at all the normal commodities, and this holds true today, by the way, as well, crude oil, wheat, and so forth, the amount of inventory that is held in warehouses or tanks or grain silos or whatever it may be is about 3 to 4 months of production at any given time. If any inventory builds up more than that, we call it a glut, and the price collapses. There's two commodities for which this is not true, and those happen to be gold and silver. So according to the World Gold Council, and I don't necessarily buy their number, the official inventories of gold amount to about 80 years of current mine production. So it would take, if we took this and set this aside, it would take 80 years at the current rate of production in order to recreate that hoard of gold that exists right now. And so that gives this enormous inertia. Think of it as an aircraft carrier versus a canoe being tossed around by the waves of the actions of the markets. There's an enormous ballast to gold versus any other commodity. And this speaks to this stocks to flows. For silver, they estimate 50 or 60 years. The problem with these estimates, of course, is people have been hoarding and hiding this stuff for 5,000 years. I'd like to take questions at the end, if I may, so just please, because I've got a lot of material to motor through. People have been hiding this stuff from their governments for 5,000 years. You know, the government knocks on the door, I want to see your gold. Oh, no, sir, we have none of that, sir, over here. Absolutely not. Come into our humble abode. You see, we have none of that. So how do you inventory this stuff? You can't. It's out there in enormous quantities. Some folks named the Hunt brothers, Bunker, and I forget what his brother's name was, Herbert, I think, around 1980, thought that they could corner the market in silver. But it turned out there was a lot more silver out there than these people had possibly reckoned for. And as they drove the price up, more and more and more silver just came coming onto the market, and they were buried under a deluge of silver. And it turns out that cornering it was just impossible, even for some of the richest men in the world, to even attempt such a thing. This concept of stocks to flows, another way of looking at it, economists have a concept called marginal utility. And marginal utility, marginal value for objectivists, refers to how much value you put on the next unit of that good relative to the previous. So let's say I'm walking through the desert, it's July, I'm thirsting to death, and I come upon somebody that has a gallon of water. Well, that's great. How much do I value that? Well, any amount of money that I might have, it's worth because it's my life. And then the person says, well, here's another gallon. How much might that be worth? Well, by the fourth or fifth or sixth gallon, I'm so burdened down under the weight of all this water, which weighs about 8 pounds a gallon, so what, five gallons would be 40 pounds. I say, no more, I can't even take it. So the marginal utility of water, even if it's 120 degrees in the desert, goes to zero. Well, another way of looking at the monetary commodity is it has a marginal utility that either does not decline, or if it declines so slowly that it might as well be a flat line. And that's another key distinction between the monetary commodity and any other normal commodity. So I've been leading up, and hopefully inductively, into these concepts. Money is the commodity that has the narrowest bid-ask spread, which tends to widen the least as we go into very large quantities or into very small quantities. It has the highest stocks to flows or highest inventory divided by primary production. And its marginal utility either does not decline, or technically we could split hairs and say maybe it is declining. If you have the wealth of Bill Gates, maybe you don't necessarily value any additional wealth. So it's sort of sloping down, you know, a little bit after you get to that billionth ounce of gold or so. And what can it do? Well, it facilitates trade. It carries value over great distance. That's one of the reasons why gold is so great. It takes a very small amount. You can put it in your pocket, just walk across the border, you know, get on a ship, go around the world, whatever. Carries value over time, so it's possible to hoard. And before there was savings, before there was lending and banks and everything else, this is how you prepare for your retirement, right? You hoard a little bit every week while you're working. And then you know, 30 years later, 40 years later, you can dishoard it. You take a little bit out and sell every time you need to buy groceries. And finally, and this is also a key point, and one of the defects of our dollar today, if you measure your wealth, or if you measure a business enterprise, and whether it is creating wealth or whether it's destroying wealth, in something that's objective, something that has a value that is objective, then your math works. And if you increase your gold ounces, you've created value. If you decrease your gold ounces, you've destroyed value. If you're using something like a rubber band, imagine trying to build a building and you don't have a yardstick or a tape measure, you have a rubber band. So, okay, well, we need to measure this 10 feet. Here, you just take this, we'll just stretch. That's about 10 feet, right? Well, it says 10 feet on the, anyways, this is an absolutely key concept to producing enterprises that are of a scale larger than a one-man workshop. As soon as you get to a larger scale, you have multiple people involved, you have investors, you have to be able to measure things objectively. You have to be able to say, this is what it's worth, this is what a share is worth, that this is the financial statement for the end of the year, we created money, we lost money, whatever it is. Critically important. All right, now I'm going to get into the pathological system that we have today. This graph, or this picture, is all over the internet. I claim no credit for that. But I love what it represents because it's a black hole, that there's no conceivable amount of money creation that could ever fill that. And in fact, the more you try to pour energy into it, if you're familiar with a plane that's spiraling out of control or a black hole, the faster and tighter it gets. There's no fix for that problem once you realize that's your dynamic. Okay. So just a little bit I'm really glossing over some things pretty severely here. So prior to 1913, we had something akin to or pretty close to a free market in money. And in 1913, they created the Fed to be the liquidity provider of last resort. And everything just started to go. And if you remember my graph previously, this was the beginning of when the dollar started to lose some value. It was really slow at first. It's a parabolic decay. So, the first couple of years, it's fairly slow. And now we're, of course, today, 100 years later, it's at the steeper part. So they created the central bank, and the job of the central bank is to initiate the use of physical force and fraud into the market and to force a different result than what otherwise have been produced by free people choosing for their own self-interest. In 1944, the Allied powers realized that, the war was all but over. They still had more cleaning up to do, but they knew they were going to win. They sat down at Bretton Woods and signed a treaty in which the world was basically not only broke, but lying in rubble and ruins outside of North America anyways. And so they didn't really have a lot of choice. And when the US said, here's how it's going to be, they basically said, yes, sir. Thank you, sir. May I please have another? They agreed to use the US dollar, and all the gold had been flowing into the US for at least 10 or 15 years prior to this for a variety of reasons, including that they were desperate for munitions and they were paying in good gold for the munitions. So they were their gold was dishoarded. They didn't have any. The US wasn't obviously just going to go dole it out. So they agreed in this perverse, insane agreement, they agreed to use the US dollar as if it were gold. Okay. We want this yellow metal, but you know what? We'll take this green paper and treat it just as if it was gold. And what this means, and this is the meaning of world's reserve currency, the dollar is the asset that's owned by every other central bank in the world. And then they pyramid their credit on top of that. And so there's, the dollar itself is a pyramided credit scheme. Now you take that top of that pyramid and build another pyramid on top of that. This is absolutely nuts. This is absolutely crazy. But notice that, I'm sure you all read articles out there that talk about the dollar's world reserve currency status is going to come to an end. How exactly is this going to end? You can't just change the balance sheet because you have a new officer that gets elected. This is the balance sheet. If the Bank of England owns X number of dollars and that's their reserve asset, what are they going to do? And then, of course, today everybody borrows the dollars. You owe the dollars. You can't get out of that obligation without a calamitous result, which we're starting to see in Greece today. By 1971, the U.S. had been abusing this world's reserve currency status for almost 30 years. And so to back up a little bit, in 1933, which I don't have on here, Roosevelt confiscated the gold of U.S. citizens and said it's illegal to own gold for U.S. citizens any longer. But the dollar was still redeemable in gold by foreign central banks. This is a key distinction. Of course, that was a meaningless promise for him to extend. The last thing in the world that the banks of Europe were trying to do was redeem. In fact, all their gold was being sent here because they could see war was coming, and they wanted to get their gold out of the war zone and into the U.S., which was the logical place for it to go. So that promise was a meaningless promise. Well, by the 1960s, the European banks, and particularly France under Charles de Gaulle, was redeeming dollars literally by the Navy boatload. They sent their naval armada over to redeem an enormous number of paper dollars and take the gold and physically load it on their Navy boats and sail it back to France. The U.S. Treasury was losing, I think it was like on the order of 100 tons a day of gold by this point, and it was a national emergency and a crisis. Clearly couldn't be sustained too much longer. And so Nixon said, and what most people expected him to do was to say, fine, we're revaluing the dollar. It's not $35 an ounce anymore. It's now, whatever, $80 an ounce, and then the flows would have stopped. He said, nope, it's no longer redeemable at all. We have a purely paper system, and because the entire rest of the world was using dollars as if it was gold, the entire world was plunged into the regime of irredeemable paper. This is an incredible monetary experiment, something that had never previously been attempted, for good reason. And now we just say we're all in. Let's just dive right into this. This is going to be great because now we can expand credit as much as we care to, and there'll be no downside, and this will be rainbows and unicorns forever or something. Now the challenge here, and this is why I say this is not a pure fiat paper, the dollar is a debt instrument. And it's borrowed into existence by a mechanism that the US Treasury goes to the market, if you can call what we have today market. The US Treasury goes to the market and sells some bonds. And the Fed is prohibited from buying directly, so they wait a week and they buy it off of whoever bought it directly, so they have a backroom understanding with the primary broker dealers, the big banks, the Morgans and the Goldman Sachs and so forth. And the Fed creates dollars to buy these treasuries. And at the end of the day, the US government, the Treasury, is the liability. To the Fed, the Treasury bond is an asset, and the dollar is the liability. So the Fed has balanced books. They have an asset, which is the bond. They have the dollar, which is the liability, and that's how it works. Of course, this is a very circular, I call it a check-kiting scheme, because the treasuries are redeemable in dollars. And the dollars are backed by treasury bonds, which are redeemable in dollars. It's literally that dare I say, stupid. Or maybe we're stupid for tolerating this. So this is, in fact, if you expand this and outside just the Treasury and the Fed, the entire system, everybody's asset is somebody else's liability. So, you know, in gold, we have a positive value. If you own a lump of gold, you own a lump of gold. Now we've transitioned to a negative value where you own somebody's owing. You own somebody else's debt. And it's good so long as the other party can pay the debt. But there's a problem with balance sheet consolidation, which is if I have an asset and then the other party defaults, well, my asset goes away. And so now because I've borrowed money in order to lend to this other party, so now I'm impaired and now I'm insolvent. And once this thing begins unwinding, this is the process of total collapse. So in economics terms, we'd say in this irredeemable paper system, there is no extinguisher of debt. It is not possible for any debt ever to go out of existence once it is borrowed into existence. This is very perverse, but a very, very, very important point. Let's say this young lady sells me this half a bottle of water. And so I take the bottle of water and I say, okay, I don't have any money today, but I will owe you a dollar. Now tomorrow I come and say, okay, you know, here's the dollar. Well, the debt has not been extinguished. It's been transferred. Now I don't owe you the dollar anymore. The Fed owes you the dollar. Now what do? Well, you deposit that dollar in the bank. Well, it's not in anything. What you're doing is you're lending it to the bank. Now the Fed owes the bank money and you and the bank owes you money. Now what is the bank going to do? Well, they're going to buy a treasury bond with it. That's how they pay you interest on your deposit. So it's just, all we're doing is we're just moving the lump under the rug from here to here to here. But we can't actually fix the problem. We can't actually extinguish debt. And so we have this particular property when people talk about what's sustainable. Economic growth is sustainable, but exponential growth in debt is not sustainable. And so it must grow exponentially because there's the VIG that has to be paid every month. And so we have to borrow more money into existence to pay the VIG, to pay the interest. And so this will grow and grow and grow until it can't. And that's the dynamic, that's the theme of my talk this morning, is that everything will continue until it can't, but there are very real forces of why it can't. Well, this, as soon as the debtor cannot pay the interest anymore, then the debtor defaults and then pushes that default onto the creditor. And if the creditor was leveraged up 40-1, then that creditor becomes a debtor who defaults. And that's another way of looking at the same problem. We have an absolute tower of debt. This 20 trillion, so that they acknowledge, actually it's more than this now, this slide is 6 months old. I think it's close on 16 trillion now, 15.7, something like that. I don't know the exact number. I'm adding 5 in because the US government has explicitly agreed to backstop all of the liabilities of Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, and presumably Ginnie Mae, and the student loan bubble is the next one that's going to be going over, in my opinion, and Federal Housing Authority, FHA. So I'm adding another 5 trillion of actual, not contingent, but actual liability on the federal government's balance sheet. I'm not even counting Social Security and Medicare, the net present value of which, yes, that's 100 trillion. I mean, I've seen numbers ranging from 80 trillion to 130 trillion. Who knows? Maybe it's worse than that. Maybe it's not quite as bad at that. But just looking at that, some of the math here, assuming there's 100 million people in the productive sector, so that's not on welfare, not in the military, not working for the government, not working for a company that sells to the government, because that's all essentially being paid for by tax dollars, you have $200,000 each in debt. Is there any possible way, any conceivable universe in which that's payable by the average person? Oh, by the way, everybody has their own mortgages and school loans and car loans and business debt and credit cards. And this doesn't include state and county, city, municipal sewer districts, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then in the banking system, by the way, this number is now also obsolete. I saw a number recently, it's now $700 trillion in the banking system and shadow banking system. Something that's very germane to Bank of America, a big bank out here, is their Merrill Lynch division had a $70 trillion derivatives book. And their counterparties were demanding that they post more collateral, more margin in there, to make their counterparties feel okay. And they couldn't do that, so what they agreed to do was to move all that exposure from the Merrill Lynch division to the retail bank division of Bank of America. So that exposes depositors to a $70 trillion liability. Does anybody think that FDIC could make good on $70 trillion when that blows up? I mean, there's so many pieces of dynamite with fuses that are starting to spark here, and maybe there's lots of kids running around with magnifying glasses, and I mean, there's just so many things going on in this system right now. It's almost literally unbelievable. Another big, big theme of mine that I like to harp on, everything about this is nonlinear. You can't think in a straight line. It's not a quantity of money issue. Everything is also a dynamic. You can't think of a static snapshot. Well, what's the money supply? You have to think of what's in motion, and each of these parts that's in motion, this one's moving in this direction, this one's moving in this direction, to really understand this. Can more borrowing pay off the debt? Obviously, that's a rhetorical question. No, by definition. And so as you look at the value of the dollar, and this last question here is really the crux, really the key to the whole thing. As everything is collapsing, and since what we call money is actually debt, as the debt is collapsing, the money supply is actually decreasing, perhaps very, very rapidly. But what's going to be happening to the value of the dollar when all the debt that backs it is going to zero? There isn't going to be any bid on defaulting debt. Once a bond is close to default, the bid goes away, and that's the end of that. And so this is the way to look at how the dollar dies. It dies in drowning in debt.